HLN legal analyst and defense attorney, and Paul Callan, CNN legal analyst and former New York City homicide prosecutor. Gentlemen, thanks so much for being with us.
Good morning, Alice.
So the state's attorney can bypass a grand jury. Why is that, Joe?
Well, there's a procedure that's set up, Alice, and the procedure calls for either a preliminary hearing, whereby you go in front of a judge and you just establish, Your Honor, we have enough probable cause to move this matter forward. The judge, having heard the evidence, of course, that they would lay out in such a preliminary hearing, would make that decision. And usually, again, it's just a prima facie case, just enough to show that these charges are warranted in accordance with the facts.
And
that's one way.
Well, could they have done that in Ferguson, Missouri? And could they have done that in New York City with Eric Garner and skipped the grand jury not indicting and all of the chaos that ensued?
Absolutely. Everything that applied in Ferguson applies under Baltimore law. The prosecutor had a choice in Ferguson: grand jury, probable cause hearing. He got heavily criticized, you remember, for going with this, quote, secret grand jury. Now let's see if that criticism is applied to this prosecutor if she goes grand jury as opposed to probable cause hearing. Now, she hasn't elected yet as to which route she's going to go publicly, so we don't know.
The criticism on Ferguson was the manner in which the case was presented. As Paul Callan knows, and as I know from presenting many cases in front of a grand jury, that really the procedure is your own. And what I mean by that, there's no judge there, there's no defense attorney there, and so the prosecutor is the judge, jury, and the executioner. And I think the issue in Ferguson was the prosecutor decided to present everything and make that jury make a decision. Here, I think it's going to be very specifically tailored to establish probable cause.
The prosecutor
usually
runs the show, and that's why they say you can indict a ham sandwich, because he or she's presenting all the evidence, they're running the rules, so it's a very low bar for them. They're saying in Ferguson, they didn't do it that way. They just put it all out there and made it confusing for the grand jurors. That's why some argue that you should take the case, and here, now they're going to argue, well, you should give it to the people. But let's go to the charges. Do you think that this prosecutor is going to have a hard time with her top charge of depraved heart murder, as it's called there, against one of the officers?
I think she's going to have a very difficult time not getting an indictment. She'll get an indictment because a grand jury will give her an indictment if she wants that, and a judge would as well. But at the time of trial, proving what we call depraved heart murder, very, very difficult. It's a strange charge. It's not like intentional murder, where you point a gun at somebody, intent to kill them, and you pull the trigger. Depraved heart is that it's kind of a reckless accident, but on the other hand, it shows such complete contempt for human life that it's the same thing as an intentional murder.
But doesn't that fit perfectly to if what happened inside the van did in fact happen? Doesn't that charge fit perfectly? That it's not intentional murder, but it's such reckless disregard. He wanted help. They never called for help.
It depends. It depends. Because remember, there were four stops. The driver got out on at least one occasion, maybe more occasions, going in to check on him, allegedly. Now, when he was checking on him, was he checking to see if he was okay? Or was he fully knowledgeable that Gray was in trouble and he did nothing?
But she never She never mentioned the suggestion that what was being done with the van was basically using the van as a weapon to injure him on the way there to teach him a lesson. And depraved heart murder is a very specific statute, Joey. It's designed for a very specific kind of criminal. It's not just a middle step between reckless behavior and intentional behavior.
Very fair point. And two points need to be made. Number one, as to the indictment, it's always, always more difficult to find someone guilty than it is to indict. Because an indictment's an accusation. And we defense attorneys go in front of the jury, we rip up indictments and say, ladies and gentlemen, it's an accusation. They have to prove their case. But to the indication of depraved heart murder, here's why the rough ride may not even be at issue here. If you know that someone is ailing, and you know that someone says, I need medical attention, I can't breathe, I need help, I'm in distress, and what you do, Allison, Chris, Paul, is you then say, well, let's pick up another passenger, let's make another stop, let's get to a precinct that takes 2 minutes to get to, 40 minutes later. What does that say to you in terms of, are you indifferent to human life?
You're
and
gonna
that's
have
a
to
theory.
Show that you knew that person would probably die.
Not that they would
if
die.
If you delayed.
Not that they would die, but they would be in serious risk of injury or death.
So and you're so, comfortable, Joey, that she didn't overreach. You're comfortable this is provable.
I think prosecutors, not that it's provable, but that it could be provable.
They,
in other words,
you know, I think they've got to prove the rough ride, because if he's just saying, if she's saying, well, he was in trouble and he should have gone to the hospital. That's very different from saying he's in trouble and he's going to be rocking around in that van. I could care less whether he lives or dies. That's depraved heart murder. And if it's a rough ride and he's bouncing around inside the van, she's got a shot at depraved heart. But without the rough ride, I think it's manslaughter. It's a different crime.
The driver said that he had jail-itis. Meaning he's just complaining because he doesn't want to go to jail.
But the problem, Allison, is that as a police officer, as an attorney, as somebody else, we don't know the medical status. You can't make assumptions in terms of whether someone's feigning injury or not. Your obligation, and you'll hear about rules and regulations in this case, is to get them help.
And that's why one of the criticisms, I think, is this may be premature, that they charged too quickly with these counts, and maybe this should have been a longer, more studied investigation.
I don't think it could have been charged. Listen, the bottom line is that the jury is the final arbiter of whether or not there was overreaching here.
All right.
There was a determination, there was probable cause. Let a jury see if, in fact, they're guilty.
Let's see what the next steps are. And one thing's for sure, Allison, the prosecutor can always back off and go on to other charges.
Oh,
they often overreach in the beginning. Right. But that's a conversation for another day. Gentlemen, thank you.
Can't wait to have it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can't wait to have that.